My name is Ian Rollo, and on behalf of the Gatorade Sports Science Institute, welcome to our symposium on Tokyo Calling, Beating the Heat. In this symposium, Professor Ollie Jay will first describe those hot environments in which an athlete is often expected to compete before sharing current work to develop and implement new extreme heat policies for competition. Following this, Dr. Lewis James from Loughborough University in the United Kingdom will share the latest research on hydration science with corresponding practical recommendations for exercise in the heat. Finally, we've invited Professor Neil Walsh to present on the science behind novel strategies for the athlete to consider in preparing for competition in hot environments. The aim is to communicate how science is improving our understanding of the challenges our athletes face, informing the policies aimed to protect them, and driving the strategies which will maximize their performance in hot environments. This is the schedule for today. An infographic which summarizes the key aspects of each talk will be available to download following the symposium. For the first presentation, it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Ollie Jay, an associate professor in thermoregulatory physiology and director of the Thermal Ergonomics Lab in the Faculty of Health Sciences at the University of Sydney, and lead researcher of the Charles Perkins Centre, research node on climate adaptation and health. Ollie.
Hello, my name is Ollie Jay. I'm an associate professor in the Faculty of Medicine and Health at the University of Sydney in Australia, where I'm also the director of the Thermal Ergonomics Laboratory and the lead researcher of the Climate Adaptation and Health Research Node at the Charles Perkins Centre. The title of my talk today is How Hot is Too Hot? Extreme Heat Policy Development and Implementation. Before I get started, I'd just like to declare that this talk is sponsored by the Gatorade Sports Science Institute, and the views expressed in this presentation are my own and do not necessarily reflect those of PepsiCo. As mentioned on my title slide, our research team is based at the University of Sydney in New South Wales in Australia. And this is one of the world's leading research-intensive universities in the area of sports science and sports medicine. It will probably not surprise you to hear that our part of the world is hot. As an example, in early January this year, which of course is the height of the Southern Hemisphere's summer, ambient temperatures reached new heights across Greater Sydney, with the maximum value of 50 degrees Celsius measured in the shade in the western suburbs. The blue dot that you can see on the right-hand side of this figure indicates my location on this particular day, which was the Sydney Cricket Ground. At the time, the men's Australia national team were playing New Zealand in the final test match of a four-match series. But a day like this begged the question, how hot is too hot for playing sport? The answer, of course, is it depends. There have been many high-profile examples of exertional heat illness in professional sport, and often commentators state that play should be suspended when a given temperature is exceeded. For example, the late Dean Jones advocated 41 degrees Celsius as the temperature threshold for when cricket play should be stopped. However, we know that the temperature at which adverse events have historically occurred in different sports in different parts of the world are drastically different. In fact, the heat stress risk of an athlete is determined not only by ambient temperature, but three other environmental parameters and two personal parameters. Importantly, ambient temperature is measured in the shade, and athletes who are exposed to direct sunlight are subject to intense thermal radiation, which can be quantified with the help of a black globe thermometer. At the height of the summer, black globe temperature at noon on a clear day can exceed the temperature measured in the shade by as much as 15 degrees Celsius. For example, on January 11th in 2017, I reported a globe temperature of 53 degrees Celsius when temperature in the shade was only 39. And it's worth pointing out that that is a common occurrence during the summer. Many existing extreme heat policies traditionally use the wet bulb globe temperature index to quantify heat stress risk. The WBGT is a unified heat stress index, which is derived from measures of air, shaded air temperature, black globe temperature, and natural wet bulb temperature. Advantages of this index include that it enables one to define heat stress using a single integrated value, which makes it very convenient. And this fully or partially accounts for all four environmental parameters. But this is only true if all three components of the WBGT calculation are actually measured. Often, black globe temperature and natural wet bulb temperature are estimated or indirectly derived, which can severely compromise the accuracy of the resultant WBGT values. Other disadvantages include the WBGT only assesses the environment and not the person in that environment. Critical WBGT limits therefore depend on the activity and the clothing worn by the athlete. It is also well documented that the WBGT index underestimates exertional heat stress risk in low airflow and very hot but dry environments. Since the introduction of the WBGT index in 1957 for use by the US military, numerous other heat stress indices have been developed. In total, more than 150 different indices are available. Irrespective of the index used, an extreme heat policy must include five key components. Number one, the environment to which the athlete is exposed must be appropriately monitored. Number two, physiological and physical parameters such as heat acclimation status and body size must be integrated. Thirdly, acceptable strain boundaries must be set according to the sport and the participant. For example, the level of a strain that an athlete might be expected to tolerate will be different between an elite professional adult athlete and a recreational adolescent participant. So this needs to be accounted for in the index that's used. Number four, the heat stress risk assessment needs to be displayed in a way that is understandable and actionable by all, as many people as possible. And finally, feasible and effective mitigation strategies that can be implemented once certain risk thresholds are exceeded must be identified. For the remainder of this presentation, I will share some of our experiences from developing heat policies for various elite sports such as cricket, rugby league, and tennis. In 2017, we led the development of a revised extreme heat policy for the Rugby League World Cup, which was hosted in Australia, New Zealand, and Papua New Guinea in October, November, and December, which is our summer. There was particular concern for managing the levels of heat stress that might be present in games hosted, especially in northern Queensland, Darwin, and Port Moresby, which tend to be very warm, but also extremely humid. We recommended the close monitoring of local environmental conditions in each stadium to quantify the four environmental parameters that define the thermal environment. Plus, we integrated the estimated rates of metabolic heat production for rugby league play, which we found in the literature, and the thermal and evaporative resistance of a rugby league uniform, which we measured on an articulated sweating mannequin. These six factors were combined to derive the Belding and Hatch Heat Stress Index, which is one of the 150 indices that I showed on an earlier slide, and this defines the thermal compensability of a particular environment. Associated heat stress mitigation strategies were then recommended when certain thresholds were exceeded. In advance of the World Cup, we undertook a modelling exercise to assess the levels of heat stress risk that might be expected based on the historical weather conditions reported for each location and time over the past 5 years. This method also enabled us to make scheduling recommendations whereby the highest risk playing times could be avoided. In this example here, for the Scotland Samoa group game in Cairns on November 11th, we determined that an HSI of around about 150 to 200 was likely, and that additional cooling breaks during play may therefore be needed. On the actual day, the measured local conditions were such that an HSI of between 180 and 210 were reached just before the start of play. And this resulted in the implementation of our policy, which consisted of an extended halftime break from the regular 12 minutes to 20 minutes and a 3 minute long breaks midway through each of the halves. These interventions were determined through a laboratory-based study that we conducted at the University of Sydney in parallel to the heat policy development we were doing for the NRL. We asked rugby league athletes to come and complete six separate trials in a climate chamber, during which they ran an intermittent sprint protocol on a treadmill that was designed to recreate the metabolic load associated with a typical rugby league match. The environmental conditions were 37 degrees Celsius and 50% relative humidity, which was equivalent to an HSI on the policy scale of 230. And throughout, we measured rectal temperature, skin temperature, sweat losses, heart rate, blood pressure, thermal sensation, and rating of perceived exertion. In each trial, different combinations of quarter time and half time breaks were tested to assess which were most efficacious at mitigating the rising core temperature and other markers of physiological heat strain throughout a simulated match. We found that an extended half time break was most effective, and that the addition of a 3-minute break was moderately beneficial, but only in the second half. We made these decisions based on the primary outcome measure of changing rectal temperature throughout the simulated match. Accordingly, we were first and foremost recommending that an extended half-time break should be implemented when a critical HSA value was exceeded, with the potential addition of a 3-minute quarter-time break if that was possible. The next question was, what else can we do during those breaks to reduce core temperature even further? For example, we could ask athletes to just drink cold fluids, or they could use the misting fan at the sideline, or a regular fan, or use ice towels to cool down a little further. A follow-up study evaluated this specific question. The main results are displayed here on the slide. On the y-axis, we have the change in rectal temperature. On the x-axis, we have the duration of the simulated match. The vertical dotted lines indicate the start of the match, and then the breaks that were implemented at halftime and at the end of the match. We had a control condition, an ice towel condition, fans that didn't have any misting implemented with them, and then a misting fan. What we can see is that clearly there's an effect of all three different cooling strategies, that is, the use of ice towels, dry fan, or a misting fan were superior to simply drinking cold water. However, somewhat surprisingly, the misting fan actually prevailed as being the most effective strategy at mitigating the rise in core temperature in this particular case. Therefore, we can make the recommendation that if the players and the resources are available, then a misting fan should be implemented at the sidelines during the quarter time breaks, but also during the half time breaks if that is practical. Moving on to cricket, which is a sport played by over 1 million Australians throughout the summer months every year, we were approached by Cricket Australia to develop a similar heat stress assessment tool, not just for elite participants, but also the community users as well. A key difference between cricket and rugby league are twofold. First of all, the duration of play of cricket is much longer than rugby, so rugby is typically 80 minutes, whereas a cricket match can last, on some occasions, all day long. The intensity of exposure is also very different, so the rates of metabolic heat production that are generated playing cricket are on average much lower than they are playing rugby league. An important component of this particular heat policy was that Cricket Australia wanted us to develop something that could be used by the community players as well as the elite participants. Therefore, we didn't want to rely on the measurement of local environmental conditions with an expensive device. Therefore, we linked the tool to the Australian Government Bureau of Meteorology, which provides freely available weather data. So the user is instructed to locate the nearest Bureau of Meteorology weather station and use that information. Typically, that's within 10 kilometers. Failing that, we instruct the user to use the Weather Underground application to get local weather information. Another key difference of cricket is that the equipment worn and the clothing worn is very, very different. So we measured the thermal resistance and the evaporative resistance of a typical clothing ensemble and the protective gear of cricket on an articulated thermal mannequin. This is a picture of the front of the dashboard that the user uses. So it's much more simple than the one that I showed earlier on for rugby league. The user simply has to enter air temperature, relative humidity, and wind that is derived from the Bureau of Meteorology weather station. And then this generates a risk scale from 0 to 10 with associated recommendations. If we exceed 4, then extra breaks are recommended. If we exceed 8, then extended breaks are recommended. And then if the risk scale exceeds 10, then suspension of play should be considered. A slightly more sophisticated version of our cricket heat stress calculator asks the user to subjectively rate the level of cloud cover and also provide some information as to what month of the year that it is. Collectively, these two inputs enable us to account for the amount of thermal radiation that will be reaching the cricket players and adjust the level of risk accordingly. Probably the highest profile heat policy that we've developed in the past few years is the one for the Australian Open Tennis Grand Slam tournament, which is played in Melbourne in January of every year, which of course is the height of the Southern Hemisphere summer. As most people are aware, traditionally extreme heat has been an extensive challenge for these athletes competing in this tournament. And to help address this, we have developed the tennis-specific Australian Open heat stress scale to replace the traditional WBDT index due to its aforementioned limitations. We also had to find ways to simultaneously acquire highly accurate and stable measurements of the environmental conditions at several locations at Melbourne Park to determine the heat stress that players on different courts were exposed to. This proved impossible with any commercially available devices on the market, therefore we had to devise our own. I'll provide a bit more information about that on some later slides. The heat stress scale was also customized for the thermal performance of tennis clothing, as well as accounting for the metabolic rates that have been previously measured and published in the literature of tennis players competing at the elite level on different court surfaces. We also had to develop a simple method of displaying the rating and the associated recommendations so all players and coaches could understand them. And finally, the scale also had to differentiate between the heat stress risk of elite adult participants and those in junior and wheelchair athletes. The final scale that we developed for Tennis Australia and the Australian Open provided a heat stress risk rating on a scale of 1 to 5. This was inspired by the fact that people are generally used to interpreting 5-point rating systems for assessing hazards such as fires, or for evaluating day-to-day items such as movies, hotels, or even Uber drivers. Upon reaching a rating of 5, the risk is such that play is suspended on outdoor courts. If matches are taking place on a stadium court, play can continue but the roof is closed and the air conditioning is turned on. In advance of this, scientifically proven cooling strategies are recommended to mitigate the development of heat strain during a tennis-specific scenario. For example, upon reaching a rating of 3, players are advised to apply ice towels during every break. This recommendation was based on our own laboratory study that demonstrated that ice towels are the most effective and compatible cooling strategy during simulated tennis play under very hot and dry Australian Open conditions. When comparing this policy with the previously described one for rugby league, ice towels are more effective in a tennis scenario because of the more frequent breaks in play and therefore opportunities to apply the cooling stimulus. On the other hand, the use of a misting fan in a tennis context would not be compatible because of secondary risks associated with slips and falls. The four environmental parameters measured courtside were then integrated with tennis-specific clothing and metabolic rates into our algorithm that derived the associated heat stress risk. This was then displayed to the players, coaches, and media in this final format. As previously mentioned, no commercially available device was able to provide direct simultaneous measurements of all four environmental parameters from multiple locations with the level of precision and stability needed. This was particularly important considering the potentially significant decisions that may be needed, which could ultimately include suspending play of an internationally televised tournament that is beamed into 900 million homes worldwide. Accordingly, the startup company that I co-founded with John Eisenhuth at the University of Sydney developed a prototype of the EMU, the Environmental Measurement Unit, which provided the agile decision-making capacity that we needed for this project. The prototype of these units has been further developed and deployed to implement other heat policies in Australia over the past year. In the meantime, they have been further streamlined and will be made commercially available with the heat stress management support for both sporting and occupational settings by early 2021. Using the EMUs and the Australian Open heat stress scale, we have now successfully delivered the heat policy for this tournament for the past 2 years, in 2019 and 2020. This ultimately involved the real-time monitoring of 5 simultaneous sites, 3 stadium courts, and 2 external courts. with data streamed to a central location at a sampling rate of once every 5 seconds, with data fed into our algorithm to generate the appropriate risk rating, which was then subsequently displayed around the Australian Open complex. Probably the most significant event so far has been during the 2019 women's semi-final, during which the measured conditions yielded a heat stress rating of 5. This subsequently led to the tournament referee stopping play and shutting the roof of Rod Laver Arena in the middle of the match. I think the people most happy about that, though, were the fans. So thank you very much for listening. I'd just like to acknowledge the 2020 research team in the Thermal Ergonomics Laboratory. All the names can be seen right there. And also thanks for the significant contributions to this work of the Chief Medical Officers of Tennis Australia, that's Dr. Carolyn Broderick, and of the National Rugby League, that's Dr. Paul Bloomfield. If you'd like to follow us on social media, you can see our Twitter handles there. The one on the left is my personal one, and the one on the right is the one for the lab. So thank you very much for your time, and look forward to hearing feedback about this presentation.
Professor, thank you again for an amazing presentation. We're going to get straight into the questions now. So, you know, I'd be really, really interested to on how you've measured, you attempt to measure the impact of your research through the policy. You've made great strides in developing and put into place these guardrails, but then how do you assess and quantify the impact that you've had?
Yeah, a great question, Ian. So, I mean, there's a couple of things. So there's something you can do immediately. You can assess how well the information is being interpreted by the athletes. So from the perspective of, let's say, the tennis example that I presented in my talk, is that what was quite noticeable quite early is that people were paying attention. They were looking at the scale. They wanted to know what the scale number was, and they could interpret it quite relatively easily from the feedback that we were getting. So I think listening to the way in which the athletes, the users and the coaches and things like that, the way in which they're interpreting is really important. So that in and of itself is impact, because the trouble is with a lot of traditional indices, let's say the WBGT, for example, is that kind of gives you a number. You don't really know what it means. You don't really know where the thresholds are, unless you have specialist knowledge, and that makes it really tricky. So if you can kind of translate that into a format that makes people helps people understand it better, then I think you're on the right track. Ultimately, what we're looking for with impact is if we look at the reason why a policy is in place, is to reduce negative clinical outcomes, right? So in the case of a sporting event, it's looking for a reduction in the number of heat-related illnesses. Is looking for a reduction in the number of call-outs to medics to deal with heat-related situations. So, and ultimately you can count that, but the thing is that it takes a while to be able to do that. So because you've got variability between years, it's difficult to sort of say after 1 or 2 years, well, you know, clearly we're making a big difference with respect to that, because there's variability in how hot it was from 1 year to the next. So that's something we hope we can demonstrate probably after 4 or 5 years in a definitive way, but that's the way we'll go about it, I think.
Okay, no, really interesting. Of course, that's what we're all striving to make real world impact. So it'd be fascinating to revisit that in that data and invite you back in four years' time. Sure. I wonder, you know, with regards to policy, what are your opinions whether specific policies are needed for either the youth or older athlete?
That's important. So it's very important that when we're using a particular index, that it is relevant to the population that you're applying it to. So now, I think a good example is the WBGT index, which was developed for the military in, you know, the mid-1900s. And then that's subsequently been used for all sorts of applications with modest adjustments to various things. But ultimately, that's what it was developed for. So and that's why we've kind of now stepped beyond the WBGT to find to develop indices that are more catered towards the athlete population that we're looking at. With respect to children, there is some traditional literature that suggests there are age-related impairments or impairments in thermoregulatory capacity earlier on in childhood. Those findings are debatable, to be honest, because of the methods that were used to assess those questions. Probably the best way to think about that is with reference to my other talk in terms of how one prescribes an exercise intensity. So it's really unknown right now, but we're actually, we have a generous grant from the National Health and Medical Research Council in Australia, which we're working together with the University of Canberra. Julian Perriard is our collaborator on that. And we're putting together quite a large study that's going to try to answer that question. And in fact, the ultimate goal of that project is to develop an evidence-based extreme heat policy for child and youth sport. So I don't have the answer just yet, how different that is relative to the adults, but we'll be able to revisit that in the future when we have those data in. In terms of older adults, you know, we know that there are age-related impairments in sweating, for example, as people get gradually older, particularly above the ages of 60, 65. But that's counterbalanced by the reduction in metabolic heat production, because obviously as we get older, the level of activity that we might engage in during some kind of sport that we're playing at that age will probably be lower. So you kind of have that counterbalance against that problem. But it's still important to consider those individuals, particularly in the context of the type of sports that they might be playing. So in Australia, for example, you know, bowls, for example, is something that a lot of older adults play, and then they'll be out in the middle of the day and it's very hot, and it's still a risk. So those are the type of things that we need to consider, but it's not quite the same as the exertional heat illness risks that we see in younger adults, of course.
Okay, and I wonder, you know, what you're doing in Australia and the learnings that you've gained are really exceptional, and I'm sure they'll have transfer to countries globally. So I just wonder, do you have any advice with regards to collaboration or where people could go to if looking to develop their own policy or this on these research steps in this approach?
Yeah, so I mean, it's you know, we're very keen for our you know, for this work to extend beyond Australia. I think that's really, really important. Obviously, in Australia, heat is a problem, so we're in a good place to learn about it and develop the optimal solutions. You know, from the perspective of what type of approaches people should be considering, it's really important that we get a good measurement of the environment that the athletes are exposed to. Using freely available weather data might be appropriate, but not in all situations. I think I covered that in the talk. So that's something that people need to consider. What we find is that the devices that are commercially available right now for measuring environmental conditions, particularly when there are micro environments available, and if you want to monitor multiple sites at once, that's really limited. So we've developed some technology to try to solve that problem, and we've started a startup company that is kind of around these EMUs that we've developed, these environmental measurement units, which we'd be very happy to talk to people about. But in terms of the type of index that you'd use, so once you have the environmental data, the question is, what do you do with it to determine what the risk is? You know, there are over 150 different heat indices available already, and it's important to select the appropriate one for the population that you're working with and also the conditions that they're exposed to. So that requires some specialist knowledge around that, but that's an important consideration. And then finally, I think back to probably my answer to your previous question, Ian, is that once you have that information, you need to be able to display it and translate it to the athletes, the coaches, and whoever, and the other stakeholders, to make sure that they understand what that means. So what does again, WBGT is a good example where you might have a WBGT of 32 degrees Celsius. In fact, that's quite significant heat stress, but you don't really know it based on just seeing the number. So kind of translating that into a way in which people understand what it means, I think, is important. There's been some good work around that in different domains as well. So that's the advice I have.
Professor, thank you. And thank you again for contributing to the GSSI Invited Symposium. And thank you for your contribution. Wish you all the best.
My pleasure, Ian. Thank you.
Our second presentation is on hydration research, implications for exercise in the heat, by Dr. Lewis James. Lewis is a senior lecturer in nutrition at the School of Sport, Exercise and Health Sciences at Loughborough University. Lewis obtained his PhD from Loughborough University focusing on human water balance and is currently the deputy lead for the sports performance research theme. He is also the physiology and nutrition learning and teaching discipline group lead, as well as lecturer for the university's undergraduate sports nutrition and postgraduate applied nutrition programs. Lewis.
Good morning from me here in Loughborough in the UK, to you wherever you're listening around the world. It's a pleasure to be here at this virtual ECSS conference, and I'd just like to say thank you to GSSI for the invitation to speak in this session on beating the heat for Tokyo. In the next 20 minutes, I'll give a little bit of a whistle-stop tour through some hydration research in this regard, and if nothing else, after the talk, I'll be able to tick off the bucket list item of presenting at an international conference in my slippers. I often think about water as the forgotten nutrient, but when we consider it, it's actually the nutrient that is consumed in the largest amount every day and lost in the largest amount every day from the human body. So it has the highest absolute rate of turnover among all the nutrients, and particularly in athletes who can experience very large losses of water very quickly, it can have a drastic effect on health and performance. And in some situations, we've seen losses of up to and in excess of 3 to 4 litres per hour in some athletes. And this can clearly have a huge effect on body water stores and then potentially performance. Of course, losses on their own don't mean that there's necessarily any effect on body water stores, but what we do see is this phenomenon of involuntary dehydration. And even in the presence of adequate water, when exercising, individuals tend to drink a lot less than they actually lose in sweat. And this means that dehydration accrues over the course of an exercise session. And if that exercise session is prolonged, and particularly if it's in the heat where sweat losses can be very high, dehydration can be quite large by the end of the exercise. And therefore, that might influence performance towards the end of a competitive event, for example. Also in training scenarios or some competitive scenarios, dehydration that's present at the end of a session needs to be recovered before the next session if dehydration is not going to be present at the start of that session. And that's another area that the hydration is really important. But in most competitive settings, it's starting well hydrated and dehydration accruing and becoming significant towards the end of events. From a consensus point of view, the most recent consensus was this one from the ACSM in 2007. There's been a number of really good comprehensive reviews by a number of different authors since then, but this was the last consensus, and I think probably it's about time for another one. But what this consensus statement said was that dehydration of greater than 2% body mass degrades aerobic exercise and cognitive/mental performance in temperate, warm and hot environments. And I'm going to focus mainly on aerobic performance here because a lot of the contemporary research in this space is looking at that at the moment. We consider temperature, environmental temperature, and its influence on dehydration and performance. We do see an effect there. There is an interaction. So this study from Bob Kenefick can see 4 different groups exercising in different environments, either euhydrated or dehydrated. And those conditions were produced by prior exercise, 3 hours exercise in the heat, either with or without fluid intake to produce euhydration or 4% dehydration. And if we look at a temperature similar to Tokyo, around 30 degrees C, or what we expect it to be in Tokyo, we can see that the effect on performance is substantial. But what we can also see is that the hotter it gets, the greater the effect dehydration has on performance. And this is for a number of reasons, but is important to note going into Tokyo next year. causes these deficits in performance when we've got exercise-induced dehydration is both physiological and perceptual effects as a result of dehydration. So we see a decrease in plasma volume and a consequent increase in plasma osmolality. We also see increases in thirst when fluid isn't ingested or can't be ingested, and we also see decreases in mood. And there is a link between these two, because of course increased plasma osmolality will signal thirst if it's sufficiently high. But these physiological effects result in a number of functional effects. So changes in cardiovascular function, changes in body temperature, so decreases in thermoregulatory function, and then also changes in metabolism that manifest in potentially increased muscle glycogen use. These physiological and perceptual effects will all feed into RPE that ultimately will either in singular or in combination with a number of these factors impair endurance performance. And this is the mechanism by which endurance performance is impaired. And the hotter it is, the more deficits in cardiovascular function and temperature regulation will likely influence performance. And that's probably one of the reasons why there's a greater deleterious effect of dehydration in the heat. However, this vast body of literature over almost 100 years, you know, many hundreds of papers, are potentially limited for a number of reasons. And I think there are two main ones in my eyes. And these are two areas that we really need to tighten the literature up on and generate new information in these spaces so that we can be more confident about the conclusions we make from the dehydration literature. The first one is that generally subjects are not blinded from the study intervention. So this means that somebody knows when they're dehydrated and they know when they're euhydrated. This wouldn't happen in any other area of exercise nutrition. You know, sports nutrition research. It just wouldn't be possible. If you did a study in supplements, you'd be rejected from any journal if you didn't blind the supplement intake. However, with dehydration, that's exactly what happens. Unblinded studies are accepted in journals. And of course, there's this common conception that dehydration is bad for performance, and athletes believe this. There's a number of surveys that have shown that, and therefore the effects on performance might be because of nocebo or placebo effects associated with not drinking or drinking respectively. Second of all, the methods that are used to induce dehydration are pretty uncomfortable. You know, things like 2 days of no drinking, 1 day of no drinking, doing 3-4 hours in the heat of exercise without any fluid at all. They're things that aren't very comfortable, but also that the subjects aren't used to doing. And perhaps if you introduce an intervention that is uncomfortable and unfamiliar, that on its own might influence performance out with any effects of dehydration itself. There are a number of scientists that do have other contrasting views, and many of those are put in these articles here, and I'd recommend anyone goes and reads these excellent articles to get an understanding of the balance of the literature, and I think there's some really interesting debates there. These contrasting views are derived from studies like this one. And this is a study looking at marathon runners and how quickly they complete the marathon and correlating that against their body weight change over the course of the marathon. And you can see here that there's a significant, albeit relatively poor, correlation between weight change and race time, suggesting, and this has been suggested in some of the papers, that increased weight loss or increased dehydration, because in the few hours of a marathon, most of the weight loss will be water and sweat. So increased dehydration results in increased racing performance or decreased race time. So this is a little bit controversial in my mind. I think if we were going to think about the direction of the relationship, clearly correlation isn't causation, but if we were going to think about the direction of the relationship, I think it's probably going to be the other way around. The faster you race, the more sweat you're going to produce, the less time there is available to drink, the less comfortable it is to drink, the less easy it is to pick your drinks bottle off the drink station. So therefore, it's more likely that faster racers are going to be producing higher levels of dehydration. What's interesting to do is to pick out the faster ones. So this is the fastest finisher out of this group, around a 2:30 marathon. But you can see they lost about 6% of their body weight. So that's a significant amount, and certainly far in excess of what we see impaired performance with lab-based stuff. But even then, 2:30, 2:35 for a marathon is, you know, I'd be very happy with that time, but it's by no means elite. If we consider the elite, we see a perhaps even more alarming picture. So this is Haile Gebrselassie from, I think, the 2009 Dubai Marathon, where he ran 2:05 and a bit, and finished with a body weight change of, or body weight loss of about just under 10% of his body weight. So a significant level of dehydration, but yet he managed to run a world-class time. So this begs the question, if we're seeing these levels of dehydration and weight loss amongst these really good athletes, is it really impairing performance? Now, of course, it would be nice if we could get Haile to do two races, one where he does his typical 10% and one where we can perhaps, you know, control him to 7%, if that's possible to get him to drink enough comfortably to do that. And then we could really see that. But it's not going to happen. But it does beg this question, does dehydration really impair performance? And I think the answer to that is very simply and very definitely yes. And the reason is this figure here, okay? The common symptoms associated with dehydration. At a 5% body weight loss of water, we see difficulty concentrating, 10% muscle spasms and delirium, 15% circulatory failure and death. And certainly there are no situations where circulatory failure or indeed death are compatible with optimal performance. So at some point on this continuum, dehydration will impair performance. The important question is when, and certainly whether the sort of levels of dehydration that are experienced by athletes in everyday athletic settings, whether those impair performance. And that's really where we need to interpret the data in the context of these main limitations that I think are present. And this is what we've been trying to do. We've been trying to address these limitations in the hydration literature for the last 7 or 8 years now. One that I want to talk through is study blinding, and on the day that I got ethical approval to start my study in looking at dehydration in a blinded way, this study was published from Paul Larson's group, and kind of had done what we'd wanted to do. Luckily, they used a different technique, same technique that was used by Stephen Chung's group, and that's intravenous rehydration. So using isotonic saline to infuse back into cyclists while they're cycling or after they've cycled in one bout to produce differences in hydration status at the start of a performance test. We proposed a different method. So whilst both of these studies showed no difference in performance, I think there are possibly methodological reasons for that. And our review published last year kind of outlines what those are in my view. I'm not going to go through them today. But we used a slightly different technique. And so we carried on with our study. And what we proposed to use was this intragastric feeding. So we place a gastric feeding tube, either nasally or orally, and then we can infuse water directly into the stomach from behind the subject and out of their field of vision. This allows us to use the same type of fluids that are consumed during exercise by athletes, and therefore we hope to produce a more realistic physiological picture of dehydration and euhydration. In this study, they did 2 hours of intermittent exercise and then a 15-minute performance test where they had to complete as much work as possible. We hypothesized, because we thought that when we removed the knowledge of dehydration, that the performance would not be that much different between the dehydrated and euhydrated trial, but actually we were wrong. Our data suggested, in line with many other studies that have gone before in an unblinded setting, that dehydration of about 2.4% impaired exercise performance by about 8%. And we were really interested in this and we wanted to follow it up. So a PhD student who's now completed and doing a postdoc with me, Mark Funnell, followed this up and did an extra layer on top of it as well. So similar study design, 2 hours of steady state exercise in this case in the heat, followed by a time trial with various measures throughout. We infused or didn't infuse fluid in a blinded manner, and we allowed water intake in small amounts every 10 minutes so that some fluid was being consumed in all trials orally. What we did was we added a second group here. So we had the blind group that did exactly the same as what we did in that previous study, nasogastric infusion of water, body temperature and in small amounts so that it's not possible to detect what's going on. We used a cover story telling the subjects that we were investigating the effect of drink composition so that they weren't aware that we were looking at dehydration, and the success of that cover story was verified from interviews after the trial. And then we recruited a second group who just did a normal dehydration experiment. They either drank or didn't drink the fluid, and there were no tubes involved and no blinding involved. And this allows us to separate out the effect of knowing that you're taking part in a dehydration experiment from not. The groups were pretty well trained, 63, 64 mils per kg, and similar cycling history and training. We saw very similar physiological and perceptual responses in line with what we would expect for dehydration. So similar decreases in plasma volume, increases in serum osmolality, increases in heart rate and thirst, increases in body temperature and increase in RPE with dehydration. And these are the classical symptoms associated with dehydration during exercise. And there was no difference between the trials for this at the point at which they started the time trial. Sorry, no difference between the group. So what do we see from a performance perspective? Now, we thought that the unblind group would show similar responses to the previous literature in the past, and that they did, an approximate 10% reduction in performance. The temperature in this study was 31 degrees C, if I remember rightly. So, you know, not too dissimilar to that study of Kenefick et al. 2010. But what we thought would happen with the blinded group was that whilst we thought performance would be impaired, we thought that impairment would be significantly less than the unblind group. But actually it wasn't. So again, we were wrong. It's always nice to be wrong sometimes, but you know, making a bit of a habit of it with these blinded hydration studies. But nonetheless, really interesting finding and actually quite important when we reflected on it, because what this does is actually validate a lot of the previous literature. So if the study has looked at 3% dehydration, it doesn't matter, probably, in my view, whether they're blinded or unblinded, the results are probably valid. And that's important for interpreting this previous literature. But what these two studies did say to us is that, you know, unequivocally, dehydration does impair endurance cycling performance in the heat. And I think we now have the evidence to be able to say that. There's a couple of other studies that support that as well. But what about unfamiliar and uncomfortable dehydration? And obviously that's not something we considered in these blinded studies. And going forwards, we will need to merge these two areas. But is it possible to become familiar or habituated to dehydration? And that's what we tried to answer in this study here. And the main idea for this came from looking at this field-based data with athletes experiencing very high levels of body weight and loss and therefore dehydration. So what we did in this study was a typical hydration experiment, some preliminary trials and then two experimental trials, dehydrated and euhydrated, where fluid was manipulated over a 24-hour period to produce some dehydration or maintain euhydration. Then they did a 45-minute treadmill run at about 75% VO2 max, either with no fluid or with adequate fluid, before then doing a 5-kilometer time trial on the treadmill. What we then did, which is a little bit different to other studies, is we did 4 habituation sessions with the dehydrated protocol, not the performance test, just the protocol, and then we repeated the whole experimental trial. What did we see? So the pre-habituation trials, we saw a typical 6% reduction in performance, and this is consistent with a number of other running studies that are out there, very consistent in the literature. After the 4 familiarizations, just 4, we saw that had reduced down to a non-significant 1% reduction in performance. And the dehydrated running performance was improved by 5%. Now, the really striking thing for me was the similarity of the responses between these subjects. Everybody's dehydrated running performance got better after they had been habituated with dehydrated exercise. So this suggests to me that with exposure and repeated exposure to the dehydration stimulus, it's probably possible for athletes to become accustomed to that. And this might explain some of the better tolerance in some of the well-trained endurance athletes that we see out there. So does dehydration really impair performance? And is it something that's worth thinking about for Tokyo? The answer is yes. But we go back to the point that I made earlier. It depends on the situation and the environment they're in, probably. But also at this time, it probably is only possible to say with any certainty that dehydration impairs performance for dehydration of greater than 2 to 3% of body mass, endurance cycling performance, exercise that's in the heat, and in males. In all other situations, we don't have robust data to support this. And that's what we need now. We need more studies investigating different environments in females, different levels of dehydration, to see whether there are effects in those sorts of areas. And also modes, because of course, in running, for example, you carry your own body mass. So a reduction in body mass could be ergogenic potentially. We also know that repeated exposure to dehydration may allow athletes to better tolerate mild dehydration. We don't know about more severe dehydration, but mild dehydration, you seem to be able to habituate to it. So practical take-home messages thinking about Tokyo next year. First of all, if you're working with an athlete or you are an athlete, you need to know that athlete's sweat loss and their expected sweat loss in the event and try and limit it to less than 2% dehydration if possible. That will be the best way of preventing performance decrements. You can practice competition drinking strategies. If dehydration is likely to occur, perhaps practicing the strategy might make that dehydration less, and that would be an advantage. And then finally, if dehydration is inevitable and it's unavoidable, then perhaps some training in competition hydration conditions to familiarize that individual with dehydration might be necessary. For many athletes, that might just be part of their normal training routine or other competitions that are leading up to that major competition. That just leaves me to say thank you very much. Acknowledgements to all of the students that have worked with me and the collaborators, and thank you to GSSI and to ECSS.
Thank you, Lewis, for an excellent presentation. We spoke to Ollie previously about core temperature. So I wonder if you could just expand on the role of hydration and its impact on core temperature.
Yeah, I mean, certainly in the heat, and like you say, Ollie's perhaps better to talk specifically about core temperature and heat, but core temperature will be one of the factors that might limit or influence performance. And we know that hydration is almost a modifiable factor that can influence core temperature. So maintaining better hydration, and in the studies that have been done, maintaining you hydration versus allowing, dehydration of greater than 2% to be produced, seems to better maintain core temperature. So you get a moderation of core temperature response when exposed to exercise in the heat. And there's probably two reasons for that in my mind. The work that we've done has suggested that dehydration increases core temperature, out with any effects of drink temperature, because we provide drinks at a temperature very close to body temperature, and still saw changes in core temperature with, or increases in core temperature with dehydration. So there is an effect of hydration, but also it's possible to modify the temperature of the drink that's provided, and that will have an influence potentially on heat storage and core temperature in the body. It probably, whether that's a good thing or whether a cold drink is a good thing will partly depend on the environment that you're exercising in. But given we're talking about Tokyo, which is a humid environment, cold drinks are likely to have a beneficial effect on core temperature and potentially performance. And there's some nice work from Jason Lee from his PhD in the 2000s that demonstrates that quite nicely, as well as some other nice research from other groups.
So following on from that, we know that especially providing cooler, more flavoursome beverages improves the perceptual response during exercise. So I wonder if using your research model, do you think it's possible that you can try to tease out the physiological benefits of fluid ingestion with the against or versus the perceptual benefits that we might get from drinking during exercise in the heat?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, that's something that we've thought about quite a lot with this model. I mean, they're not easy studies to do where we're placing nasogastric tubes during, cycling in a hot environment, it's not a hugely comfortable thing to do, so they're not easy to do. But yeah, with that model, I believe we can look down the almost the GI tract to see where that effects are coming from. At the moment, we don't know that. We just know that if we manipulate hydration in a way that's consistent with what athletes experience, and in our studies, again, we've used quite extreme examples. We've done very little fluid intake, not no fluid intake. They still, are consuming, 150, 200 mils an hour, even in the dehydrated trial. But it's a very low intake versus a very high intake. Clearly, we need to potentially interrogate the various different mechanisms that might be responsible. We can do that with this technique, but we also need to look at kind of how much fluid is needed. Do we need to ingest all the fluid that we've been providing to almost maintain new hydration to get the same benefit? There's research out there that's looked at drinking to thirst or planned drinking and kind of replacing pretty much everything that's lost. And can we start to mimic some of those scenarios with this model as well, is something that I'm interested to look at.
Thank you. And then you finished your presentation by advising people to practice their hydration strategies. Now, could you expand on that really and offer some advice on what you'd recommend for the perhaps, the frequency of this practice, or what that would look like, and how long people would have to follow that routine to really get benefits to their exercise performance?
Yeah, I think it's going to be speculation to most of those questions, to be honest, Ian. The study that we did, which is one of the only ones to show that you can almost become accustomed to dehydration, used 5 exposures. So that suggests that some tolerance can be built up within a relatively small number of exposures. That was, one dehydrated trial at the start and then 2 exposures a week for 2 weeks. So I guess some of that might happen relatively quickly. I think that's an important consideration potentially for studies that are going to go on looking at dehydration. So should we be familiarizing people partly with the dehydrated protocol that we're going to use to get useful information out of those studies? Obviously that is potentially difficult because you have to put people through a couple of familiarizations with that dehydrated protocol. But in terms of an athlete, I think if you think about it from a practical perspective, most athletes will experience some level of dehydration in training comparable to what they would see in competition. And I'm thinking more of perhaps endurance athletes here. So if we take runners, for example, when they're doing their long runs, it's very rare that a good level, half marathon or marathon runner will carry fluid with them. So therefore, by default, they're doing an hour or 2 hours of exposure to dehydration in a manner that's similar to what they're going to experience in competition, probably more severe than in competition because there's going to be more drink stations in competition. So those type of athletes, cyclists, triathletes as well, will probably largely expose themselves to the type of conditions that they'll see in competition in training. Also, at least with say triathletes, they compete relatively regularly. So again, they will experience those losses. I think it's going to be athletes that train with fluids, but perhaps compete without fluids. So I'm thinking here maybe football, for example, or soccer, should I say, where in training, fluids are readily available. And in my experience, most training sessions, there's drink breaks every 10 to 15 minutes where players can take fluid. But in a match, you've got probably 50 minutes for the first half and maybe 50 minutes for the second half where you've got no availability of fluid. So the training to competition environment is very different from a fluid intake perspective and opportunity for intake perspective. And I think those are the situations where some practice would be beneficial. In terms of how often, over how long, I don't have a number for you, but I'd probably say, once a week would be probably a good thing. You do need to consider athlete health in that regard as well. Things like, kidney health and potentially, urinary tract health as well. If you're promoting dehydration during training. So then the emphasis has to be on rehydration after training to bring that athlete back to where they need to be.
Okay, excellent. Lewis, thank you once again for contributing to the GSSI invited session, and really appreciate your time and your thoughts and input, and look forward to catching up with you soon.
Yeah, cheers, pleasure.
Our final presentation will be delivered by Professor Neil Walsh, Practical Strategies to Beat the Heat, Recommendations for Heat Acclimation by Post-Exercise Hot Baths. This will be delivered by Professor Neil Walsh. Prior to joining the School of Sport and Exercise Sciences at Liverpool John Moores University, Professor Walsh spent 19 years at Bangor University, where he and his team produced leading research in the areas of nutrition, immunology, heat acclimation, and developing new techniques for non-invasive biomonitoring of athletes and soldiers. He currently serves on the editorial board of Medicine and Science in Sport and Exercise Immunology, and also provides education and training for staff at world-leading sports teams and organisations. Neil.
Hello, my name is Neil Walsh. I'm at Liverpool John Moores University, and the title of my talk is Beat the Heat, Heat Acclimation by Post-Exercise Hot Bath. It's important to note this talk is sponsored by the Gatorade Sports Science Institute, and the views and opinions are my own. So what will I talk about today? I'll provide current practice for preparing athletes for the heat, and then I'll talk about our strategy that uses a hot bath after exercise in temperate conditions. I'll present the original work we published on this, and then answer some other questions that have troubled my group, such as, is taking a hot bath after exercise effective in well-trained individuals? How long do the benefits last, the heat acclimation benefits by post-exercise hot bath? And how does taking a hot bath after exercise for heat acclimation compare versus conventional exercise heat acclimation? Indeed, are there any other benefits even to health of taking a hot bath regularly? The Romans believed so. And how is it that I can train cool, bathe hot? Some simple guidelines for putting this into practice. So what's current practice? Well, obviously, athletes are aware of the penalty to the performance of exercising in very hot and humid conditions, and they're typically recommended to spend up to 10 to 14 days acclimating to the heat. Here's some findings from a group of 307 athletes who are preparing to take part in the World Athletics Championships in the heat and humidity of Beijing in 2015. The athletes were a range of field sports, sprint sports, and endurance athletes. A half of them had actually experienced heat illness symptoms to that point, and 1 in 12 had actually experienced a previous heat illness episode, a collapse. Almost all of these athletes, when assessed, had a fluid consumption strategy for the championship. But the rather startling and damning finding is that only 15% of these athletes who knew they were going to perform in hot and humid conditions actually heat acclimatized by spending 2 to 3 weeks in a natural hot environment to get the adaptations, plasma volume expansion, etc. It gets worse. Only 2% of those endurance athletes at the event heat acclimated in an artificial indoor environment like an environmental chamber. So it seems that there's a problem in translating what the sports scientists are saying that athletes should do to prepare and what they actually do. Why is this? Is it because acclimatizing in the natural environment or acclimating in a chamber is costly, it's impractical, it gets in the way of the taper and the final preparations for the athlete when they're traveling to a competition in the heat? Are there better, more simple ways of doing this that an athlete might engage with? Is it because the athlete thinks they're already heat acclimated through part of their training? Of course, as it shows on this slide, and we've always said, you know, that part of getting fit is getting hot. When I train every day, even in cool or temperate conditions, I get hot as part of that daily exercise. So surely I'm already heat acclimated. Maybe that's why they don't do it. It was around about this time in the mid 2015 that we started some work looking at whether there was a simpler way to provide heat acclimation by simply taking a hot bath after exercise in temperate conditions. It would be simple, low cost and accessible. It wouldn't affect the daily training that the athlete was doing. They could train as normal. So the aims of our study were to examine whether over 6 days taking a hot bath after exercise in temperate conditions would induce hallmark adaptations of heat acclimation, a lower resting core temperature, of course, earlier onset of sweating during exercise heat strain, lower end exercise core temperature during exercise and heat, and of course, whether that translates to an improvement in endurance performance in the heat. Here's the protocol. First, 2 to 7 days before the main trials, we did some preliminary testing, VO2 max testing, establishing the exercise speed for the main trials, familiarizing to our time trial. And then what we had is some experimental trials. The first day, individuals came to the lab and performed in 18 degrees, so temperate conditions, a submaximal exercise bout, followed by a 5 kilometer treadmill time trial. Why did we do this? Well, we did this because around about this time, there was great traction for the idea that if you heat acclimate, this might actually improve performance even in temperate conditions. So we incorporated that here. Participants then had a rest day, and the following day in the chamber, they performed at 33 degrees C, 40% humidity, exactly the same preload exercise on a treadmill, followed by a 5 kilometer treadmill time trial. The group was then split. 7 of them were on a control intervention for 6 days. Normal daily exercise, 40 minutes, 65% VO2 max, in an 18 degree so temperate environment. And then a thermal neutral, if you like, bath after exercise for up to 40 minutes. So this was a control condition. And then the group at the bottom, HWI or hot water immersion, there was 10 of them. They did the same daily exercise in temperate conditions, but then they were immersed in a hot bath. Within a few minutes, they transferred to the bath. They immersed all their body up to their neck, including their arms, in 40 degrees hot water. After a rest day, they then repeated the experimental trials. On day 11, it was the 18 degree trial, including the time trial, followed by a rest day, day 12, and the following day, of course, the post-trial for the 33 degrees warm environment. What did we actually see? Here are some of the interesting variables from the day-to-day intervention. And I've highlighted in the red box at the bottom what I really want to pull out here. Often it's been interpreted wrongly from our original paper in Scandinavian Journal of MedSci Sports that the participants would have to do a 40-minute hot bath after exercise every day. Actually, they don't do that. Only 4 of our participants completed the full 40 minutes hot water immersion after exercise on the first day. The individuals exit the bath when they feel really uncomfortable and they get out. Each day, the individuals made a little bit longer in terms of the time they could withstand immersed in the hot water. By day 2, it was 6 individuals, 7 completed by the full 40 minutes by day 3, and almost all of them, only 1 of them at day 6 was pulled out, and that was because they exceeded our core temperature cutoff of 39.5 degrees C. So it's not a necessity to do a full 40-minute bath each day. In fact, our participants couldn't cope with that. So the time constraints are not as bad as you might think. What did our data show from the main trials? On the left, you see resting core temperature. One of the hallmark adaptations, of course, is a reduction in resting core. 9 out of 10 of our individuals on the hot water immersion experienced a reduction in their core body temperature at rest. It's almost like a pre-cooling effect. If you look at the right-hand panel, which shows the exercise core temperature at the end of the heat trial, pre is shown in the white bars, and the dotted bars, of course, are the post. What you can see is even in the temperate condition trials, we did see that 9 out of 10 of our individuals who'd done the daily hot water immersion had lower core temperature during exercise in the 18 degree environment. But 10 out of 10 of our individuals reaped benefits in a reduction in thermal strain, shown on the right, in the 33 degrees trial. And the average reduction in end exercise core temperature was almost 0.4 degrees C. Many experts in the field think that a meaningful reduction in core temperature is about 0.3 degrees C. So as I say in the advantage at the bottom of this slide, most exercise heat acclimation studies lasting 5 or 6 days exercising in the heat in a chamber, typically at a clamped core temperature of 38.5 degrees C, most of them don't show a reduction in resting core temperature. But we routinely show a reduction in resting core temperature with a post-exercise hot bath. The red dotted line here shows that if you look at the white bar on the right side here at 33 degrees C, above that red dotted line is the penalty to core body temperature of exercising in the heat of 33 degrees C. When our individuals had performed the 6-day hot bath intervention, you can actually see that now the bar has come down on the right to the red dotted line. So hot water immersion each day after exercise abrogates. It prevents this penalty, this impairment to body temperature. What happened to the 5 kilometer treadmill performance? The upper panel here shows the time to complete the 5 kilometres. You can see there was no benefit of daily hot water immersion on performance of the 5K in the 18 degree environment, but there was a clear improvement in performance when it was a hotter environment at 33 degrees C. And you can see in the lower panel, the grey bar along the bottom shows the typical day-to-day variation of about 2% in time trial performance of this length. And the tails you can see there show that actually, you know, we got a really compelling improvement in performance of about 5% improvement in 5K running performance in the heat in those that had done the 6-day hot water immersion. Again, the red dotted line now shows that the hot water immersion intervention prevents the impairment to performance that we see in 33 degrees C, which is the area in the white box there above the red dotted line. We had a number of other questions that we were then left with after our initial findings that really excited us. We wanted to know, and we were asked regularly by Elite Sport, well, does this work in endurance trained individuals? It's all very well to do these studies in the recreationally active sport and exercise science students, but what about in highly trained? Because I showed you earlier that the highly trained, the elite athletes, their engagement with heat acclimatization or acclimating in a chamber is not very good. Is it because they believe they're already adapted? Well, in this study, we tackled that, published in Frontiers in Physiology. We had a group, as you'll see on the left side of the slide, of endurance trained individuals. There were 8 of them. They were doing on average 9 hours of exercise a week. Their VO2 max was 68 mils per kilogram per minute on average. They were compared with 8 recreationally active individuals, only doing about 3 hours of exercise a week and a more modest VO2 max. The exercise you see here in the main figure in the middle is the standard 40 minute treadmill run at 65% max in 33 degrees and 40% humidity as before. And what you can see really clearly in the figure is that the endurance trained individuals at post do gain a meaningful advantage in a reduction in core temperature after the hot bath 6-day treatment. Yes, it's a bit lower than the recreationally active, 0.36 degrees C reduction in the endurance trained versus almost 0.5 degrees C in the recreationally active. But we are seeing that highly trained individuals do reap benefits from the post-exercise hot water immersion. Another question that troubled us for a while, and we then published this paper on this question, was, well, how long do the benefits from post-exercise hot water immersion really last? We know, as shown in the bullet towards the bottom of the slide, Garrett's work, that if you do only about 5 or 6 days of exercise heat acclimation in a chamber, typically the adaptations, which are relatively modest, are lost by about 2 weeks afterwards. So you need to carefully time your exercise heat acclimation to your event, when your event will occur in challenging environments. Here in our study, we performed the normal 6 day post-exercise hot water immersion. And you can see in the second checkered bar, we saw about a 0.3 degrees reduction in end exercise core after a day's rest after the 6 day intervention. Remember from the last slide that the magnitude of adaptation does depend to some extent on the level of fitness and training status of the individual. What we were really pleased to see that at 1 week later when they did the exercise heat test, and at 2 weeks later, there were still benefits in terms of the reduction in end exercise core, a reduction in thermal strain during exercise heat stress. And we wonder if the benefits in many studies at post are affected by almost short-term overreaching. You need to leave enough of a rest period after 6 days of exercise in the heat, or in this case, exercise followed by hot bath, for the individuals to fully recover. So the benefits are still available at 2 weeks later. Here's the results of some very recent findings, as yet unpublished. Robbie McIntyre, one of my current PhD students, has done this really nice comparison to tackle another question that we've been asked regularly by elite sport, which is, this is all well and good about this post-exercise hot bath, but how does it really compare with more conventional exercise heat acclimation? So this study has done exactly that comparison. As you'll see in the white box on the left, the daily intervention in one group, we had 27 participants in total, equally distributed into three different groups. One of the groups was a thermoneutral exercise group. They did up to 60 minutes of treadmill running each day, 65% VO2 max, in a 20 degree environment. And then the really important group here was the EHA, or exercise heat acclimation group. They were work matched to the thermoneutral exercise group. We staggered the throughput of participants so that we could work match them, very important, and then establish the benefits of the additional heat that they experienced. Because the exercise heat acclimation group did the same exercise as the thermoneutral group, only in 33 degrees C and 40% humidity, so much warmer. And then we have the hot water immersion group. And pilot work in our lab has shown that the endogenous stimulus, the number of minutes, if you like, in core temperature above 38.5 degrees C each day, was comparable between the hot water immersion group and the exercise heat acclimation group. And that's very important to allow a fair comparison to take place. And what you then see in the main figure in the middle here is the end exercise core temperature with our standard exercise heat stress. You can see that just exercising each day in temperate conditions, the white bars, after 3 and 6 days, you get very small to modest adaptations. In the exercise heat acclimation work matched to the T&E group, you can see more slightly greater adaptations, whereby end exercise core is down at about a 0.3 or so degree reduction from the pre-level. But importantly, the hot water immersion appears to elicit more rapid adaptations. For example, if you look at after 3 days of hot water immersion, when we performed the exercise heat stress challenge, the adaptations were equivalent to those after 6 days in the exercise heat acclimation. So much more rapid adaptation in the hot water immersion group. It's worth pointing out these individuals were a little less fit than our original study, and that we think accounts for why the final exercise core temperature was around 0.5 degrees C lower after 6 days than at pre. So to summarise here the benefits we've shown in this programme of work, we believe the new mantra should be train cool, bathe hot to prepare for the heat. So the athlete can do their normal training here, you see on the left side of this infographic, after their normal training in temperate or cool conditions. On 6 successive days, they should bathe almost immediately or within the first few minutes after exercise in 40 degrees seawater immersed to the neck, as you see in the picture. They do this for up to 40 minutes. And we have shown that this improves performance in the heat. You see lower core temperature at rest, lower core temperature during exercise in the heat, earlier onset of sweating, lower perceived exertion, and improved 5 kilometer time trial performance. In yellow, you can see our most recent publications. We show this is effective in highly trained individuals, that the benefits last at least 2 weeks. And very recently, unpublished, we show much more rapid adaptations with the hot bath strategy than after exercise heat acclimation. It's conceivable that there are other benefits of a hot bath. It was the famous writer Sylvia Plath who said, "I'm sure there are things that can't be healed by a hot bath, but right now I can't think of one." And of course, the Romans used hot baths, as we know. We've shown here, you know, that heat performance can improve by using a 6-day hot bath strategy. We don't know whether the benefits we show translate moving around the clock face, if you like, to the right here, to a reduction in heat injury, whether a hot bath late in the evening could reduce the time it takes to get to sleep or have benefits for psychological status or even immune health. We, of course, know that athletes might use a hot bath for therapeutic benefits to reduce aches, pains, and even as part of rehabilitation. And it remains unknown whether strength and power can improve using a hot bath strategy. So just finally, some guidelines on how to train cool and bathe hot. It's important to follow these safety guidelines. We suggest that athletes exercise moderately for approximately 40 minutes or do their normal training, but in temperate conditions where they feel warm, but not really hot and not uncomfortable. As soon as possible, they take a hot bath after exercise in 40 degree water immersed to the neck. And they do this for 15 minutes on the first day, just to be safe. And then each day, they should increase the bath duration by about 5 minutes, up to 6 days. Of course, it's important to say that if in doubt, get out. If you feel too hot when you're in the bath, just get out. You should feel hot when you're in the bath, but not as hot as you can stand. And then when you get out of the bath, to sit for a few minutes, just to make sure you recover and you don't get lightheaded. Thank you very much for your time. I'd really like to thank a few of these individuals who, without which we couldn't have done this program. Thank you very much indeed.
Professor, thank you for another great presentation. I'm really interested in the dose with regards to the hot water immersion. You know, is 40 minutes sufficient? Can we get the same effect with a shorter duration, or is prolonged exposure even more beneficial?
Thank you, Ian. Yes, we, in our original study in 2016, we had individuals perform 40 minutes of exercise first in temperate conditions, moderate intensity exercise for 40 minutes. And then within a couple of minutes, they went into the hot bath, immersed to the neck. Now, the sort of often a misinterpretation of our original paper in 2016 in Scandinavian Journal of Medsci Sport was that each day the individuals did a 40 minute bath after exercise. That wasn't the case. It was up to 40 minutes. And actually, as you know, in my presentation, I shared that on the first day of the 6 days of heat acclimation, only 4 individuals actually completed the full 40 minutes. Actually, the average time they spent in the bath was about 32 minutes. Each day in the 6-day intervention, we find that individuals can tolerate a greater duration of hot bath, building up to 40 minutes. And by day 6, all of the participants can withstand 40 minutes in the hot bath. So actually, the time commitment each day is not as much as 40 minutes in the bath after your exercise. And in our practical recommendations, we actually recommend that individuals do a 15 minute bath on the first day, comfortably. They feel hot, but not so hot they can stand for 15 minutes, which is not a big time commitment. And then they build up by 5 minutes each day and building up to 40 minutes by day six. And that parallels not too far away from what our participants actually did in that study. So it's not a 40 minutes commitment. We are doubtful that the participants would be able to withstand longer than 40 minutes. And of course, there are practical disadvantages then if the athlete's expected to, you know, sit in a bath for longer than 40 minutes. Most of our studies we've published and our pilot work shows that even if participants don't do exercise before a hot bath, they actually can't really stand much longer than 40 minutes in 40 degree water anyway. So we've hit that perfect blend of optimal adaptations, but also practical, you know, time constraints. So it's between 15 on the first day and then 40 minute time commitment on day six.
And following on from that, what would your suggestion be to say if athletes completing this routine twice a day rather than once a day? And what kind of duration would you suggest leaving in between, even if that's a possibility or a consideration?
We've not tried this. I mean, that's a really nice idea. Our approach has always been the practical one, that they can get a wash while they're in the bath. They jump in after their normal training in temperate conditions. And of course, as you allude, you know, most athletes train twice a day. So why not? I see no reason why it wouldn't be beneficial. We think that the main driver here is the dual stimulus, as we call it, the raised core body temperature, but also the clamped elevated skin temperature while the individual is immersed to their neck in a bath. So the water temperature is 40 degrees C. So compared with exercising in the heat to heat acclimate, you know, we've got a larger stimulus here. And as we show our unpublished observations in the slides, we've even got some evidence that the hot bath strategy, you know, it makes more rapid, it augments the adaptations compared with exercising in the heat. And there is actually some work on performing two bouts of exercise heat acclimation a day over a few days that again is quite positive. So you could, if you really had, you know, limited, you know, the time constraints you have were quite tight, you only have a 3-4 days, there's absolutely no reason why once or twice a day training followed by a hot bath wouldn't actually make more rapid the adaptations. It's a good idea.
Yeah. You know, so following that, the benefits or necessity to the clamp, the skin temperature and raise core temperature, I wonder, some foods we know elicit a sweating response. Some hot foods can elicit a sweating response. So would you see any benefit to heat acclimation by using some of these thermally inducing foods?
Right now, it's hard to comprehend that. I think we are all in this world, you know, really connected with the need for a raised core body temperature to stimulate the endogenous stimulus, if you like, for adaptation, but also the raised skin temperature. And our work is certainly pointing towards that. Others have shown the importance of high skin temperature in adaptations too. Whether certain stimulants foods can, you know, actually influence adaptation is in question right now. But I think we need the empirical evidence as always, Ian.
Professor, thank you once again for your time and contributing to the GSSI invited session. We really appreciate your time, insight and knowledge. So thank you, and look forward to catching up soon.
Thanks for having me in.
Thank you for attending the GSSI invited session. Information on how to download the infographics from today's talks will follow shortly. Alternatively, please visit the GSSI website for this information and to access a host of educational resources in sports nutrition. I hope you enjoyed this invited session and you enjoy the rest of the Congress. Thank you.